Science in Fiction. I must say that is a brilliant title for a seminar. And as a science reporter, I must say I love it when I find ways to use fiction in my science stories, just as I think the creators of the Big Bang Theory love to use science in their fiction. I will tell you a bit about that. But first, since I got this really broad title for my talk, I decided to use the opportunity to say something about how this particular show, The Big Bang Theory, has changed my life. As you heard, once upon a time I was a physicist, and that was hard. But the hard part wasn't the physics or the mathematics. That was fun. Well, most of the time anyway. The really hard part was meeting new people. And the supposedly innocent question that you knew would come sooner or later, the question, so what do you do? And the reaction you would get when you answer, I'm a physicist. I think everyone who has ever been a physicist knows what I'm talking about. The reactions weren't always the same. There were a few alternatives. One was a complete blank stare. The person would just look at you with empty eyes and then slowly back away to or find someone else, possibly more human, to talk to. Once in Norrlands Nation in Uppsala, I was left alone in the middle of the dance floor when the guy I danced with learned that I was a physicist and he just left. The other reaction was the outburst, oh, physics, I just hate physics. That was the most boring and pointless subjects of all in school. One person, a priest actually, asked me, what is physics anyway, more than cat skin and ebonite rods? Well, if you got any other reaction, you could be pretty sure that you had just met another physicist. I found those reactions quite hurtful, actually. And it wasn't until years later that I realized that maybe they were meant as a kind of compliment. But now I think things have changed. I'm so happy to say that this bunch, or more correctly, these guys, the creators of the Big Bang Theory show, changed this. I realized this just the other week because of this seminar, when my 15-year-old daughter learned that I was going to meet David Salzberg. She was simply awestruck. And she said, please tell him how much I love Sheldon Cooper. Really, my 15-year-old daughter loves Sheldon Cooper. Somehow, the creators of the Big Bang Theory has managed to make an odd physicist like Sheldon Cooper to someone cool. So cool, in fact, that my daughter loves him as much as she loves Jon Snow from Game of Thrones, or even Benedict Cumberbatch. So, my guess is that there are a lot less of blank stares or I hate physics comments for physicists nowadays. All it took was a highly successful sitcom to make people realize that science is incredibly fun and something you can do for a living, as David Salzberg put it when I interviewed him the other week. I really would like to thank the show on behalf of all misunderstood physicists and all physics students in the world for making it cool to be a physicist. So, back to my subject, science in fiction. I don't do physics anymore, since I'm now a science reporter. That means I still get the blank stare sometimes nowadays when I tell people what I do, that I'm a journalist. But that is a completely different kind of blank stare. It doesn't say, oh, you're a physicist, you must be really smart. It says, oh, you're a journalist, you cannot be very smart. However, for me, that is an improvement. Because as a journalist, I get a chance to ask all those stupid questions I never dared to ask when I was a physicist. It's even my job to do it. My all-time favorite Sheldon Cooper quote is, I'm a physicist. I have a working knowledge of the entire universe and everything it contains. To paraphrase it, I would say, I'm a journalist. I can ask stupid questions about everything in the universe, and it's my job. Being a science reporter is the very best job you can have. At least I thought so until I met David Salzberg. I must say his job makes me a bit jealous. Well, if David's job is to put science into the story, then my job is to make stories out of science, or to turn scientific results into a story. Patrik Hadenius, the editor-in-chief of Forskning on Framsteg, what can we say, the Swedish version of Scientific American, maybe? He has described it in a very good way. He explained the difference between being a scientist and being a science reporter like this. You scientists get paid to read boring articles. We, the science reporters, have to write articles that people are willing to pay to read. That is, making scientific results into stories that people enjoy to read. As I said, this is the best job there is. I get to talk to the top scientists in every field. Every week, I get to know about at least one completely new area of science that I didn't know about before. And it's my job to get into it and understand it at least so well that I'm able to explain it to my readers and make it into a story. I'm going to tell you a secret about science writing. The hardest part is not reading the scientific reports, although I have to agree with Patrik Hadenius that they can be quite boring. Understand what they are about, finding the right scientists, convincing them to talk to me, or convincing my editor that it's really an exciting result to write about and something we want in the newspaper. The hardest thing is to start a story and to start it in a way that will make people want to read it all the way to the end. And my own personal favorite trick is to use fiction. It is to begin the article with some quote or reference to fiction, because I've found that the most effective way to tell a story about science is to do it by using fiction, and I'm not the only one. One of the most famous science writers of our time, Sir Simon Singh, he wrote a whole book about mathematics and pretended that it was about The Simpsons, but it's really about mathematics. If you haven't read it, you should. It's a great book. I only wish that I had had an idea that was that bright myself. But I use fiction too, as I said, whenever I can. The first time I realized how useful fiction is in science writing was almost 3 years ago, when I had just started my job as science editor at Dagens Nyheter. I was going to write an article about ADHD. And that happened to be the week after the film about Percy Jackson premiered in Sweden. I guess most of you are not very familiar with Percy Jackson. He's not as famous as Harry Potter, but he is a favorite in my family, as is Harry Potter. Percy Jackson is a troubled boy from New York with ADHD and dyslexia, who finally learns that this is because he's a demigod, a son of one of the Greek gods, with a brain hardwired for ancient battles. And I realized that the movie and the story about Percy Jackson was the perfect way into the subject. So here's the article, illustrated by an image of the movie. Percy Jackson, son of Poseidon, is the one to the right, holding the golden fleece, next to his friends Annabeth, daughter of Athena, Grover, a satyr, Clarys, daughter of Ares, and Tyson, who is wearing sunglasses to hide the fact that he's a cyclops. I was very happy with the result, and since then I try to use fiction when possible, even though it had turned out not to be so often. Some examples. This was one I enjoyed very much, although it wasn't so serious. It was from a study of the Christmas special of the Medical Journal of Australia, where the authors had analyzed the diets of the different characters in The Hobbit by J.R.R. Tolkien. And found that the big difference between the good guys and the bad guys and your likelihood of survival in Middle Earth is how high your intake of vitamin D is. It's also the one article that has generated the largest amount of angry emails in my inbox. And that is to say something, believe me. And it's all because of this image that says Legolas is a high elf. Apparently he's not. And people were so upset. So if any of you is interested in the detailed genealogy of Middle Earth, I have loads of emails to forward to you. My next example is an article on the singularity, or the time when computers get smarter than us. I really love this page, by the way. And again, I used fiction to start the article. A quote from the movie Transcendence with Johnny Depp that premiered the same week. The quote was, "For 130 years, our capacity to reason has remained unchanged. Once online, a sentient machine will quickly overcome the limits of biology. And in a short time, its analytical power will become greater than the collective intelligence of every person born in the history of the world." It was a very good start of the article. Another favorite article of mine is this one. Maybe this doesn't really qualify as fiction, but the comic strip XKCD by the genius Randall Munroe, and his web page and book, What If? Serious scientific answers to absurd hypothetic questions, is an absolutely brilliant way to present science, in my opinion. As I said, starting an article with a quote is my favorite trick. Here's another example where I used it. An article on whether it's a good idea or a really bad idea for us to try to contact other civilizations in the universe. There I was lucky, because one of the persons in the debate is physicist and science fiction writer David Brin. I must admit, I'm not really a science fiction fan myself, but my husband is. And David Brin happens to be one of his favorite authors. So we have lots of books of David Brin at home. And it was easy to find a short story, Lungfish, which deals with this exact problem. So I started my article with a quote from the short story, where a few ancient robots placed in the outskirts of the solar system to protect humanity from attracting the attention of other not so friendly civilizations. The quote, "We had no way of knowing humans had evolved until the creatures themselves invented radio. And then it was too late. The first transmissions are already propagating, unrecallable, into a deadly galaxy. If there are destroyers around in these regions of space, the humans are already lost." Actually, at that time, I had to argue with one of my editors to start the article like this. The editor didn't think people would understand the article if I started with a quote and wanted me to explain the background first. And I disagreed and managed to convince the editors of my view. I've also used poetry by Harry Martinsson in an article on the leap second. Juni natt blir aldrig av. And just before Christmas last year, I could write about the science in Star Wars, The Force Awakens. Like what really happened on board a spaceship that starts to fall freely down to a planet. Or if there could be planets completely covered in forests. Or what does Han Solo really mean when he brags about how his ship, the Millennium Falcon, did the Kessel Run in 12 parsecs? When parsecs is a unit to measure distance and not speed. Or time. And of course, last Sunday, I could, thanks to Torsten Wiesel, Sveriges Unga Akademi, and David Salzberg, write an article on the Big Bang Theory. Thank you to all of you. I'm not finished. I have some more ideas for the future. For a long time now, I've been thinking about doing something on the science in Game of Thrones. And the main question for me is how years can be so important in a society when the years aren't defined by seasons. That is, when winter or summer can be many years long and you never know when it ends, would the concept year even be something remotely meaningful in such a society? So, sooner or later, I will write that article. You will just have to wait and hopefully continue to read Dagens Nyheter. Finally, some advice to you scientists. As I said, my job is to turn science results into stories that people, hopefully, would be willing to pay to read. And the stories don't have to be fiction. But if you talk to me, please tell me about the interesting details of your work, about the scientific process, about where the idea first came from, or about your mistakes. Was it something your five-year-old said one day at the breakfast table, or a really unexpected meeting 25 years ago in Beijing, or something else, that finally led to this result? Please let me know. It will make it a much better article, and more people will read it and learn about the very fascinating research you are doing. So, thank you very much.
It was a really wonderful presentation. And I think you were so, it's so nice to hear this thing of the image of researchers getting affected by the Big Bang Theory, where you made a great job for that, because I don't think it's only physicists that realize that. Because I get from everyone I know that, wow, this really cool theory, but that scientists can be really fun. And we have this summer school in the summer where high school students come. And one of their first reactions when they come and meet our members in the Young Academy is that, wow, can scientists be so much fun? And that's really, I think, something we need to learn our young kids. But I'm curious to hear, when you select what to write about in the journal, mm-hmm. How do you get your ideas?
You know, I get that question all the time, and it's so difficult to answer. I get the ideas from all over. Of course, we follow the big scientific journals like Science, Nature, and all the big ones, and we get loads of I get loads of emails. I got lots of tips. I have contacts with scientists. What I'm interested in, what's going on in the society at the moment, you know, and of course, films and TV shows.
So you don't need a hotline to us.
Helpful for more ideas. So please contact me.
Yeah. Do you have any questions from the audience?
Thanks, great talk. I was wondering, because you mentioned that you have to sometimes convince scientists to talk to you, and I was wondering what's your experience on that, if it's hard actually to make them talk to you. That's one question. And second question would be, how do you think we should communicate science if the better idea is to make scientists better science popularizers, or actually the burden should be on the journals like yourself, or you just see it like it should go hand in hand?
Well, the first question first. I've been a science reporter for 15 years, and I must say the attitude of Swedish scientists has changed so much during that time. 15 years ago, it was really hard to make a scientist use words that people understood. I mean, popular science was not very well regarded 15 years ago, and now you have changed a lot, you guys. I mean, it's much easier for me now, because I can explain why I have to write an article that people who are not in the field can understand, and why I have to simplify sometimes, and why I have to use not the correct terminology of the field, but words that people understand. And the other question, I think working hand in hand is a good idea. I think you are better at doing the science part, and maybe I am better at popularizing it. So I like to cooperate with you.
Do we have any more questions? So once again, warmly thank you. And I will.